is the Holy Spirit play. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
If you were with us last week, if you weren't, go back and watch it. Hallelujah. You'll need to see it in order to enjoy the benefit of it. Hallelujah. We started teaching on, are you a grasshopper or a giant killer? Yeah. Are you running around like a grasshopper or are you running like a giant killer? And we get that from the book of Numbers, chapter 13, the entire chapter, by the way. And it says, as they came to the end of this chapter, chapter 13, because remember, we'll just kind of rehearse without reading this entire chapter again. But they, children of Israel, were sent, they chose out the spies, one from each tribe, to go into the land, search it out, to see what the land was like, you know, all the things, you know, the fruit, the walls, the cities, the people, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they go in, they spy out the land for 40 days, they come back. When they get back, they remember they brought the one cluster of grapes. Now, again, I went to Food Line, got some seedless red grapes in a little bag, and it was a cluster. I could hold it with my finger. Just, all right? It weighed maybe a pound. Maybe. That was a cluster of grapes. They brought back a cluster so big they had to put a staff on the shoulder of two men and hang it over that. That was some serious grapes. All right? Serious harvest going on there. And they came out and they brought the report. They told the children of Israel, the land flows with milk and honey. The land has all this. And then they stopped and started going, but the people there eat up the inhabitants thereof, and that the cities are walled and the people are great. And we saw the giants and, you know, and all this kind of stuff. Caleb comes up and says, let us go in at once. We're well able. And the 10 spies go, we're not well able. And then we get down to the end of the chapter and it says this. It says us in verse 32, we brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel. The land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people that we saw are in the men of great stature. And we were, and we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which were come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. And so we were in their sight. And here is the difference between looking at your circumstances and living by faith. Because when you look at things from your position and your viewpoint and how you can see it, you are defeated. But you have to gain a different view. You have to have a different perspective, and that is the perspective of God. Okay, so we read all that last week. That's kind of bring us up to date. So we want to cover the points of what grasshoppers do. All right? They are not David Carradine in Kung Fu. A grasshopper. Okay? You know? We're not talking about that kind of grasshopper. All right? We're talking about people that see themselves as grasshoppers instead of giant killers. First thing about a grasshopper is they say what they see. Faith people don't say what they see. They say what the Word says. Now listen, I understand, without getting, you know, in bondage to confession or making statements, that there are times you have to articulate what's going on in order to deal with it, but that's not what you're believing in. Okay? There are times somebody says, you know, how are you doing? Well, you know, I need prayer. For what? Or you go, I don't need prayer. Now, let me ask you something. Now, Jesus said in one place, if any two of you agree is touching any one thing, it shall be done in my Father in heaven. Let me ask you a question. How can you get somebody to agree with you if you don't tell them what you need the agreement on? Now, I grew up Pentecostal. And in the Pentecostal church, we have prayer requests. Anybody got a prayer request? You know, well, brother, pastor, so-and-so, and then we'd have those. Kind of like we came in on the, you know, off the live feed, somebody sent in a prayer request. And then we say, how many unspoken requests do we have? Everybody go. And I often wonder if they just did that because that's what you're supposed to do, to look like you had a prayer request, although they didn't. Look like Flipper in there. Flip, flip, flip. Now, I got a question for you. How many of you believe that when you get out of church today, you can run down, there's a McDonald's right down the road here. You can get into the drive-thru, pull up to the little speaker there, and they say, "May I help you?" And you go, "I have an unspoken order." How many believe that when you get to the window, you're going to get exactly what you want? "Well, I believe by faith." No, stop it. They can't fulfill your order because they don't know what you want. You got an unspoken order. We do that in church. I have an unspoken request. I want you to agree with it. Are you serious? I said, are you serious? You got an unspoken request? Nope. You got to say what you need. So, I understand that there are times that, you know, when you're encouraging people to join you, you want people to become part of you, you want people to be a part of what you're praying about or in agreement with you, you've got to articulate it. That's not saying what you see. They're just stating what you need prayer for. Okay? Hallelujah. Am I on? Hallelujah. All right. I wasn't on, but I'm back on. Okay. Hallelujah. It's good to be back on. Sorry if we lost you there for a minute. I hope you were reading lips. So, it is not saying what you see to gain people who to come into agreement with you. You have to declare what it is you're agreeing on in order to agree. Hello? Are you here? You go home. Let me say this. It is not agreement if the person says, "I'm having surgery and I need you to agree with me that I'll have a successful surgery." "Well, I'm just going to believe you're going to be healed and won't need the surgery." That's not agreement. Now, either you get that person up to where you are or you come down to where they are, but you're not, until you get into agreement, you're not in the prayer of agreement. Okay? How could two walk together except they be agreed? Okay? Now, I know this isn't part of saying what they see, but some people, see, we in our circles, the Word of Faith charismatic circles, we can get, and listen, I've been around this, I've been in this for 35 years, 36 years, running these circles, and I know, I've seen it all. How many remember the puking in the bag to get the devil out, pigs in the parlor? Well, about 20 years ago, that came out again. Everybody, have you heard this? Every Christian's got a demon. You got to vomit the demon up. And I'm like, listen, I saw that come through the churches and when I was a kid around 6 times. You think it's all new. This has been going on for years, and everybody gets flaky and squirrely with it every time it shows up. You know, then we got to fix all the mess after it all clears up. You don't have to vomit to get rid of devils. And every Christian's got devils, and they got a nest. I mean, you get crazy. I said, we can get crazy. What do we do? Stay with the Bible. Amen. If you say, yeah, what a concept. Stay with the Bible. All right? You know, we got a couple of cases, or maybe one case, where the demon threw the person down, and they foamed at the mouth or something, whatever. That was an oddity. That wasn't the norm. Most times, Jesus said, come out, and it left. You don't talk to every devil. He talked to the legion. He said, "Who are you? You know, what is your name?" He said, "We're legion, for we are many." I know people are going to cast out devils. I got to ask them, "What's your name?" And people get real original. "We're legion." One guy said, "I cast the devil out of a guy." He said he was in Mussolini and in Hitler and in Stalin. I thought, my goodness, you got the head demon, didn't you, buddy? And when you study the Bible, you'll find out that demonic activities, principalities, and powers are regional. They stay in regions. So Hitler, Mussolini, and Stalin weren't all in the same place. They were in different regions. That same devil wasn't running around all over the place. People get, we just stay with the Bible. I said, stay with the Bible. Now, that I got off on all that because people, grasshoppers, say what they see. Now, they're saying what they see because they're saying what they believe. They're not asking for prayer. They're not asking for agreement. You know, then on the other side of that thing, we try to get, well, I can't say it because it's unbelief. Well, if you want me to agree with you, you got to tell me what it is. If we're going to stand in faith together, I got to know what it is. Okay? Well, I'm not going to make that confession. They smack you a couple of times. You know, the old skin bracer commercial. Thanks, I needed that. Some of us need that. We need to be smacked around a couple of times. So, then what do? They, nevertheless, we were grasshoppers in our sight, so we were in their sight. So they say what they see. Secondly, grasshoppers are moved with fear. See, people of faith are ready to go and possess the land. People of fear is, we can't do it. Luke chapter 21, 26 says, men's hearts fail them for fear, and are looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken. You look around the world today and you can live in fear. Are you here? I said, you can look around and you can just live in fear. I mean, you know, the nutbag in North Korea wants to nuke us. All right? You got, you know, Islamic terrorists who want to destroy us. You got people who are radical ex-military nutbags who want to blow up the government. You got people who hate you because you're white. You got people who hate you because you're black. You got people who hate you because you're Latino. I mean, you got people trying to, everywhere you go, there's, you know, this fear is being spewed out. Fear is being spewed out. But you know what? Men's hearts will fail them for fear, but we are not of those men, glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, like Brother Hagin used to say, you're not ready to live until you're ready to die. Once you get born again, the life of God's in you, you're ready to live. Amen. Hallelujah. That means what? That means that no matter what happens on this earth, no matter what comes, no matter what kind of crazy thing happens, we go to heaven. We will be able to be absent from the bodies to be with the Lord. We can live life fearlessly, praise God. Now, I don't mean I go out and lay on, you know, go out there and, you know, stand in the middle of traffic and get run over by a tractor trailer saying, well, you know, I live life fearlessly. No, that's stupid. Remember Jesus said, you don't tempt the Lord. When Satan tried to get in and throw himself off the temple, you don't tempt the Lord. So we don't tempt God. But we can live life fearlessly. But see, the grasshoppers live their life in fear. Thirdly, grasshoppers give the enemy courage. Remember they said that we were grasshoppers in our sight, and so we were in their sight. Now let me tell you about the people on the other side of Jordan River. Are you ready for this? They'd already heard God brought them out of Egypt. They'd already heard about the plagues, news traveled. They heard they walked over across the Red Sea on dry ground, and the entire Egyptian army and horses and chariots and all were drowned in the midst of the sea. They already heard all that. They knew that Israel had a God that fought for them, hallelujah. And they know no matter how big and how strong and how powerful they were, they couldn't stand against the God of heaven and earth. But when you get into fear and you begin to see yourself as a grasshopper and you're not standing in faith, you give courage to the enemy. You embolden the enemy to come against you. You embolden his hand. Why? Because he knows you're not connected and you're not standing on the promises of God and you're not standing in your place, and he's just going to come in and take you out if he can. Judges 16, 23 and 24. The Lord of the Philistines gathered. Now this is after they captured Samson. And hair was cut and lost his strength. Now that's a whole nother story. Hello? And it's not about a woman. You know. I mean, there's lessons in, you know, men, you don't need that woman. You don't need a Delilah. You don't need the Jezebel. Amen? You don't need to go to the enemy's camp and find somebody. You're not going to find the right girl at the pub. Hello? Well, I better stop right there before I get myself in big trouble. Then the Lord of the Philistines gathered together to offer a great sacrifice to Dagon, their god, and to rejoice, and said, our God has delivered Samson, our enemy, into our hand. And when the people saw him, they praised their God, said, our God hath delivered into our hands our enemy and destroyer of our country, which slew many of us. And he kills more when he dies. Hello? Samson did not get delivered by their God. Samson got delivered because of his sin. But when you're living as a grasshopper, when you're not living in the place that God's called you to live by faith and live as a conqueror and live victorious, you'll give courage to the enemy. Satan is emboldened. The principalities, powers, mights, rulers of the darkness of this world are emboldened to come against you stronger and to come against you stronger and to come against you stronger. Are you here? Number four, that the grasshoppers bring up evil reports. God says of the children of Israel, notwithstanding, Deuteronomy chapter 1, verses 26 and 28, notwithstanding, you would not go up, but rebelled against the commandment of the Lord your God. You murmured in your tents and said, because the Lord hated us, he brought us out of Egypt to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites to destroy us. Whither shall we go? Our brethren have discouraged our hearts, saying, the people is greater and taller than we. The cities are great and walled up to heaven. Faith crowd. Now, who is this bunch that said this? The same one that saw the 10 plagues. The same ones that saw the splitting of the Red Sea. Are you here? Y'all go home. The same bunch that saw all that now goes, the people are stronger than we. There's a song that I don't remember who actually did the Ringling Singers and Band did it all the time. He'll do it again. You've got to remember that the God that brought you out will bring you in. I said, the God that brought you out will bring you in. You got to stop looking at God like Israel. He brought us out to kill us in the desert. Why? He could have just left you there and let you die in captivity. Why did he bring him out in the first place? He remembered his friend Abraham. He remembered his covenant. And the God of the covenant brought them out with a strong arm. Amen? And then they got weenified. We don't need weenified Christians. If you want victory, you can't live like a weenie. You can't live like spaghetti that's been in a pot of water, hot water. You get a wet noodle for a backbone. Can't have wet noodle backbones. You've got to be able to stand, look face to face, eyeball to eyeball, nose to nose, and toe to toe with the enemy, and say, my God who brought me out, my God brings me in. And nothing, no weapon formed against me shall prosper, praise God. My God, he is God, and there is none else, hallelujah. Amen. Can you say amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. And so, you know, he says, and then the last thing is, grasshoppers refuse to be persuaded. What do you mean? Remember that when the 10 spies were saying we can't go in, that Caleb stilled the people and said, let us go in at once. We are well able. And the people go, we're not able. We be not able. Instead of responding in faith to a correction and a word that would change the destiny of a nation, the 10 spies refused to be persuaded. And why? Fear gripped their heart. When fear grips your heart, you cannot be persuaded. You have to rid yourself of fear. Brother Summerall used to say, as a matter of fact, he would finish every sermon he ever preached. Every time I ever heard him preach, and he would, on tapes, and live, on person, whatever, he would say this. He would say, feed your faith and starve your doubts to death. Hallelujah. What's doubt? Doubt is acting on fear. Doubt is simply believing in fear. Believing in the words of the enemy instead of believing in the word of God. See, if you meditate on the word of the enemy, you'll be full of doubt. If you meditate on the word of God, you'll be full of faith. Satan's words produce fear. God's word produces faith. They are spiritual forces. Are you here? You're going home. Luke 16:29-31 says, Abraham said unto him, they have Moses to their father and the prophets. Let them hear him. Them. Let me start over. Abraham said to them, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And they said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went from the dead, they will repent. And he said, if they will not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Now this is the story, not the parable, but the story of the rich man and Lazarus. And the rich man's calling across to Abraham across the gulf, saying, send somebody back to my brother. Let them hear. And they said, if they don't believe Moses and they don't believe the prophets, they're not going to believe if someone was raised from the dead. Let me tell you something. When you set your face like a flint to not believe, you won't be persuaded. The very nature of the walk with Christ is a walk of faith. You have to believe in what you cannot see. You have to believe in what does not make sense. Now, so to the natural carnal mind. The Bible says this, that the carnal mind is enmity against God. It resists God. It's antithetical to God. The carnal mind is. That's why we're told, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God. Somebody say amen. Amen. All right. How many give me 5 minutes? 5, 10, 15, 20? All right. 25. All right. I got anybody out there on Facebook? Go ahead and send across a like if you will give me 5 more minutes. Of course, they can turn off any time they want to, and I wouldn't know it. But God knows. Who wants to be a giant killer? I don't want to leave you being a grasshopper. I don't want you to be a grasshopper. I want you to be a giant killer. Amen. We want to kill the giants. We want to slay the giants. We want to be like David. I stopped at the grocery store the other day and talked to a woman, and she's in there, and she said, how are you doing? I said, I'm blessed and highly favored. She said, I know that. And so we had church for a few minutes. And then I said, did you know why David took 5 stones to go in battle against Goliath? And she looked at me and said, no. I said, Goliath had 4 brothers. Now, I'm not just making that up. They're in the Bible. And the last one was a 6-finger, 6-toe giant. Obviously, the character used in The Princess Bride. All right. David took 5 stones, not because he missed 4 times. He was going to take them all out. I always tell this. The other side of the story there is, don't quit until you finish the job. Because it took him the rest of his life to get the other 4 guys, because he ran off and started celebrating the 1 victory over Goliath. All right? So, what do giant killers do? Well, you know, grasshoppers only say what they see. Giant killers only see the promise. If God has made a promise, it's bigger than your circumstance. There is no situation. There is no circumstance. There is nothing that the enemy has that is bigger than what God has for the answer. Even sin. Where sin does abound, grace does much more abound. And what's that saying? That's not saying go out and sin as much as you want. God can cover it. That's saying that no matter how big it was, no matter what you did wrong, there is a grace that's bigger than what you did. God meets our need exceedingly, abundantly, above all we could ask or even think. Hallelujah. He knows what you have need of before you ask Him. And if there are giants in the land, He can send a little shepherd boy out there with a slingshot and a rock and take him down. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18 says this, while we look not at the things which are seen. How many can look at something? Bills, your body, your circumstances. While we look not at the things which are seen. We don't live in denial. Looking here is inferring. We're not contemplating. We're not feeding on. We're not accepting that as the answer. But at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal. The word temporal, temporary, temporal, is passing, means subject to change. That circumstance is subject to change. Now understand, every circumstance of life is subject to change. We don't look at the temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. The Word of God abideth forever. God's Word is eternal truth. And when eternal truth comes up against that which is changeable, there's only one thing that can change. Y'all hear you going home? The temporal. The subject to change things. The circumstances of life. The situations you look at and you're facing and you're dealing with. They are subject to change, but when it comes in contact with the eternal. God's Word is the eternal. God's Word works in what we call the law of the Spirit of life that's in Christ Jesus. The things of this world operate under the law of sin and death. Are you here? But Paul wrote to the church at Rome, and he said, "For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. I look not at the circumstance, but at the eternal. In order to change the changeable, I have to apply the unchangeable." John G. Lake, when he went to Africa, and they were suffering from bubonic plague, he wrote in his journal, and it later became got into a book. He went into the places where people had been dying with bubonic plague, and when they would die, it was a lung. It would just fill the lungs up with froth, and they just would actually drown in their own mucousy discharges in their lungs. And he was there helping the people bury the dead and that kind of thing. And they came to him and said, "Dr. Lake, you can't do this." He said, "Why not?" He said, "These people have bubonic plague. You can't be in contact with them." He said, "Sirs, let me show you something." They went and got he said, "Get a microscope slide." He said, "You see that person's passed away there? Take and get that discharge from their mouth and go look at it." They went and put it under the microscope. He said, "Oh, yeah, it's got bubonic plague in it. It's just full of it." He said, "Now watch this." He took his hand, wiped it, put it on the slide, said, "Now go look at that." When he looked, put it on the slide, and it died while they were looking at into the slide. He said, "That, sirs, is the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus overcoming the law of sin and death." Now let me say something. Your circumstances are the same. When you apply the law of the Spirit of life that's in Christ Jesus, when you apply God's word, it overcomes that which is of the law of sin and death. Those things that are under the law of sin and death are changeable. What do you mean under the law of sin and death? Poverty, sickness, and death, spiritual death, poverty, and sickness, are all part of the fall and operate under the command of the law of sin and death. Jesus came to overcome. And so we don't look to the things which are seen, but to the things which are unseen. Can you say amen? The people who are giant killers are moved by faith. We're well able to go and possess the land. Hello? Hebrews 10:38-39 says, "Now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them that draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul." Can you say amen? Faith people run to the roar. Faith people put the sling and get the slingshot out and run out with no sword and shield. They trust, when I say this, they're being offensive. I know we got the armor of God, but they understand what I'm talking about here. Goliath has the shield. Goliath has the head. Goliath's covered. And the shepherd harp playing ballet dancing David. I don't know if he danced ballet or not, but he danced before the Lord. Anyway, he played the harp. He's out there river dancing. Seriously. I'm trying to finish this up. I only have 20 minutes of the 25 I was given. We are not of them who draw back into perdition. Faith people run to the enemy. Faith people take their stand. They draw the line. I remember that movie, the Star Trek movie, when the Borg, I forget which one it was. It may have been First Contact. I'm not sure which one it was. I think it was First Contact. Yeah, it was First Contact. You know? And Picard's up there, and the Borg is advanced here, and they've answered, and he says, "We draw the line in the sand. Yeah!" With his little Jean-Luc Picard accent. "Yeah! You got to draw the line. Yeah!" He says, "Enough! No more! Satan, we're done! Not done that I'm done. You're done. Ship your saddle home. Bar the door. Ship your saddle home, baby. You're over. You're done. It's over. I'm standing by faith and not by sight. I'm not moved by fear. I'm moved by faith. I'm moved by what God said, not by what you said. I'm not going to entertain fear. I'm going to entertain faith. And I'm going to act on it." Can you say amen? Another thing that people who are giant killers do, they cause it. Remember that the grasshoppers gave comfort to the enemy. They emboldened the enemy. People of faith cause the enemy to run in terror. It says here in James chapter 4, verse 7, "Submit yourself therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And the Bible says, that Greek phrase there literally says, he will flee from you as in terror. That's the import of the Greek there. He will flee from you as in terror. Devil's coming like the Wizard of Oz. Little man sitting back there in his machine. I'm going to kill you. I'm going to take you out. Winds, hurricanes, tornadoes, winds, you know. Took Dorothy out of Kansas. This little old man sitting back there running. Did you know that the Bible says that when Satan is about to be cast into the pit, that the people will say, is this he who caused the nations to tremble? Is this he who caused the nations to tremble? You'll be going, are you serious? I put up with all that junk. I had all that defeat in my life. I struggled with all that stuff because of him? You can be mad at yourself. Or you can do something about it now. You can be like the prophet with his servant. They that be with us are more than they that be against us. He went, one prophet. One, two, three, four, five, six. Look, I've already got the six. That's three times many we got. And they're all the way around him. And finally he says, open his eyes, Lord. And he saw the host of the armies of the Lord encamped round about them. Flaming cherubims. Hallelujah. Swords. Glory to God. In the spirit, praise be God forevermore. Don't tell me angels aren't real and the angels don't work on our behalf. The Bible says, be careful. You've entertained angels unawares. You've had angels and you didn't even know it. I said, you didn't even know it. We got people running around with some of these crazy doctrines now about watcher angels and, you know, fallen watcher angels. And they look like aliens. I've got pictures of them. How'd you get a picture? Seriously? All of a sudden, we get more caught up with demon activity than we do the fact that God has sent his angels. Hallelujah. Are you here? And they're encamped round about us, glory to God. They're ministering spirit, sent to minister. They're to minister for the service of righteousness, glory to God. They're there for us. Had a friend who's from Jordan who was a young man or a child, almost a teenager or whatever, when the 67 war was fought with Israel and all the nations came against him. He had friends who fought in it, or people he knew who fought in it, against Israel. And says they came up the dunes. There were millions of soldiers on the dunes. They not only lost the war, they lost huge amounts of land in a surprise attack. They showed up for a surprise attack and lost land and got whipped in 6 days. You don't do that. They're a nation of 2, 3, maybe 4 million back then. Unless God sends his angels. Are you here? You're going home. Spiritual forces are real. But when we stand in faith and we become giant killers, Satan, the enemy, will flee as in terror. Are you here? You'll send him away with his tail tucked between his legs, whimpering. Are you here? You're going home. Amen? Now, let me say something. Don't spend a lot of time trying to say, I command you to go away in Jesus' name and run away from here in terror. Submit yourself to God. Resist the devil. And he'll flee. It's the faith that he can't handle. It's the stand with God he can't deal with. It's your big elder brother showing up on the scene. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's already had to deal with him once. That didn't go so well for the devil. What do you mean? About Genesis 3 said that see the woman shall bruise your head and you'll bruise his heel. Now, like one guy said one time, that term bruise your head in Texas means he'll bust your head. Jesus busted his head. He stripped him of his authority. And last, I'm sorry, I didn't read the scripture for that, did I? No, I skipped one. Next, the giant killers bring up good reports. They're not looking for always. Have you ever been around Christians? All you can get out of them is, you know, Eeyore? No matter. Or you think they're auditioning for hee-haw reruns or remakes. Singing the gloom despair song. Agony on me, deep, dark depression, excessive misery. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. And then she met another, and poof, she was gone. I mean, you know, all the hee-haw was just full of faith. Not really. You know, that was funny. I mean, Grandpa was for supper. He said, washing windows are still, he's still washing windows that aren't there. Faith people bring up a good report. We're well able. We're well able to go up and take it. Let us go up at once. We're well able. Now, how do you know if Caleb was full of faith? Because they went in. They had to go out and walk in the wilderness for 40 years until everybody died of that generation that was over 20. Then they go in and they fight and they take the land. And after all the fighting's over with, Caleb comes to Joshua and says, hey, look. Now, 40 years ago, Moses promised me that when I came in here, I could have the mountain I picked out. When we went in to spy the land out. Remember that? It's about 45 years, because a few years of possessing the land, taking it, beating all the enemies. He said, now, I still want my mountain. Give me my mountain. And Caleb goes up there at 85. And there are giants on the mountain. And the old man does some serious giant butt kicking. He cleans house and takes the mountain. Don't you young whippersnappers start going, old man. Be very careful. Because they might do some serious young person butt kicking. Anyway, I'm sorry. Caleb was so full of faith, even in his old age. He said, my strength hasn't waned. I'm as strong now as I was then. See, he was kept by God. Hallelujah. And went and took his mountain. And you know them guys saw that. It's kind of like Yoda in that one of that last prequel, Star Wars 3, where he comes in on this cane. And all of a sudden, he's somersaulting all over the place. You know? I don't watch Star Wars. I know it's not real. I know there's no such thing as Jedi Knights. I don't believe in the Force. It's just entertainment. Okay? But you know, he's walking. And that's how Giants had to see that 85-year-old guy show up thinking, oh, he's toast for us. Yeah, I remember that guy. My great-grandfather told me about him. Said he showed up, and then they never came in. Here comes an 85-year-old dude thinking he's going to get his mountain. Let's show him what we can do. And they're defeated by the old guy. Because the old guy had a partner in his faith called the Lord God Almighty, the God of Israel. Hallelujah. The Lord who is strong in battle, praise God. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. And Caleb brought up a good report. Remember? And then the fifth thing that giant killers do, they refuse to be defeated. I cannot be defeated and I will not quit. Romans 8:35-39 says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, hallelujah, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Not just conquerors, more than conquerors. Can you say amen? Listen to Paul. I like the way Paul talks. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Giant killers won't be defeated. They don't give up. They don't throw in the towel. Don't throw it in. Cut me. Don't throw it in. You know. Okay. Quit, Rocky. I'm not going to quit. Quit, Rocky. Giant killers don't quit. Samson became a giant killer in the end. After all his mistakes and all of his failures and having his eyes put out, and he was put on that wheel like a beast of burden for the people to mock and to laugh at and to make fun of. They brought him for sport to the Colosseum that day, to their place of gaming. And he put it between the pillars. His hair had grown back. The anointing returned. And in his last feat of faith, he killed more Philistines in one day than he did in his whole life before. Are you here? He did not die defeated. He died victorious. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. I said, can you say amen? Father, we thank you for our time together. We thank you that Jesus is Lord. We thank you that we can be giant killers instead of grasshoppers and live a victorious, conquering life in Jesus' name. If you're watching today or if you're here today and Jesus is not the Lord of your life, by that simply mean you're not born again, you're not saved. I want you to either here, raise your hand, or if you're watching by internet, you know, join us, send something across the screen. We want to pray with you. Hallelujah. We want to say this. Now, we will lead you in a prayer. And because we don't have everybody here, we're doing live, we want to make sure that you, if you want Jesus in your life, pray this with me. Say, dear God in heaven, I come to you. Lost and without your life in me, I need to be born again. I hereby confess that Jesus is the Lord of my life. I believe you raised him from the dead, and I accept him as Savior, Lord, and Master of me. And I am now accepting and thanking you that I'm saved and born again. And your life is in me, in Jesus' name, amen.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fbc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.